Okay, we're a couple minutes late. We had a little problem with the finding an extension cord. As you can see, the room is different. You like that spongy carpet? I feel like, remember the Bionic Man? And he used to. At any rate.
That clock is wrong.
The clock's wrong?
It is 2 minutes till seven.
No, I got.
7 o'clock right now.
I got 2 minutes after seven.
7 o'clock.
Yep.
Oh.
Your nursery clock is different.
He's trying to get off, but 2 minutes early. Let him
off. Whatever. Anyways, okay. Well, it's good to see each one here tonight, and we're continuing on in Doctrines of Salvation. Tonight, we study adoption. And adoption, most of us are familiar with the word adoption. But adoption in the Bible is something quite a bit different from the word adoption as we use it today. Let's look to God in a word of prayer and we'll begin. Now, our Heavenly Father, we come before you in Jesus' name. We thank you, Lord, for the gathering together of your people. Give us, Lord, the hearts and minds to comprehend what the Spirit saith unto the churches. And Lord, we would pray that you would just bless the word of God to our hearts in a very special way. Lord, for those, especially those that are new Christians, young Christians, Lord, just bless them especially, Lord, as they maybe perhaps for the first time hearing about this, Lord, and just bless these doctrines to the hearts of all of us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, in the book of Exodus, we have an adoption takes place, and that was Moses. And the child grew, and she brought him unto Pharaoh's daughter, and he became her son. Now, that to our way of thinking, that's adoption. That's what happens. Pastor Jim is going through the process of adopting Angel, and it's a step-by-step thing, and nothing. You don't hurry the government, and so it takes a process of time. Pharaoh's daughter had it much easier. She just saw the baby floating down the river, and she got him out, and she adopted him. He became her son, but then the book of Hebrews tells us when he came to years, or when he became an adult, he unadopted himself. He refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. Now, that's the way we think of adoption most of the time. However, in the Bible, adoption is something that is completely different from this. In the Bible, when a man and a woman adopt a child, the child they adopt is their own child. And the reason for it is it's a legal Roman custom. It's something that had to be decided in court. It was a regular legal procedure. And the Romans were the ones that did this. The Jews never did have this custom of adoption. So you don't read about it in the Old Testament at all. And adoption is found five times in the New Testament. And we're going to be talking about that this whole evening. In the one column here, we have the five times that's mentioned. Now, we're going to be looking at these verses more than once during the lesson. Not all of them, but some of them. More than once with a different emphasis each time. Now, we have it the first time in Romans 8:15, where he says, "You have received the spirit of adoption." Then you have it in Romans 8:23. It says that we are waiting for the adoption. In Romans 9:4, it says, "Who are Israelites, to whom pertaineth the adoption." Galatians chapter 4 says that we might receive the adoption of sons. And in Ephesians 1, it says we've been predestinated unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ. So those are the five times that we find adoption in the Bible. Not in any of those times does it mean that you go out and you adopt someone, like you go to an adoption agency or something like that. Not once does it mean that. It always means you're adopting your own children. Okay, and it was a legal custom. The Roman father adopted his own son. And what it meant was taking that son, who would be underage, and through a legal ceremony, placing him into your own family as an adult, as a legal adult. That's what adoption is. Now, if you take your Bibles, please, and turn to the book of Galatians. And in Galatians chapter 4, those first seven verses, we read about what adoption is and how it works. Galatians chapter 4, starting with verse 1. That's in the New Testament, Kay.
Thank you very much, Raymond.
And now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, infant or underage, as long as he is a child, differeth nothing from a servant, though he be Lord of all. Let's say there's a wealthy man, and he only has one son, and who is an infant or a young child. And it says here that there's no difference between his status in the home from that of a servant, even though he's Lord of all. The whole thing is what he's going to inherit, all the wealth and the power and all the things that go with it. But as long as he's a little child, he is no different in importance and power than a hired servant. And then it goes on and tells us that, but he is under tutors and governors, that's teachers and babysitters. He's under tutors and governors until the time appointed of the father. The child has no say in anything of running the household because he's a child. He could not inherit anything if his father was to die at that time. It would be put in a trust and he would get it when he became old enough. But verse 2 says he's under teachers or tutors and governors or babysitters until the time appointed of the father. Now that time appointed of the father is when the adoption takes place. The father sets a time and he says at this particular, on this particular date, I'm going to adopt my son. And what that means is he says, my son, oh, he's a little guy, he's going to be legally adopted, placed into my family as a grown adult with all the benefits of adulthood, all the benefits that go with adulthood. Verse 3, even so we, when we were children, under age, when we were children, we were in bondage under the elements of the world. Just like the child is under the teachers, the tutors, and the governors, he says we were under bondage from the world. We had to do what others told us to do and so forth. But, verse 4 says, but when the fullness of the time was come, God sent forth his son, made of a woman, made under the law, to redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. And so here we find adoption, and it's used in the context that we are to receive. This is something we receive from the Lord Jesus Christ, when God sent forth his son to redeem us. At the time that he redeemed us, not only were we born into the family of God, but we were adopted into the family of God at the same time. So the Bible says you must be born again. We're born into the family of God. That's how you get in. You're born into it, just like in your earthly family. But what God does for us is he brings us into the family of God through adoption, brings us in as legal adults. And therefore, we are heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. We are eligible for all the blessings of God to be showered upon us because of the adoption. Verse 7, wherefore thou art no more a servant, but a son. Remember in verse 1 we read that the child, as long as he is a child, is no different from a servant. He has no better status than the servant does. He can't order anybody around, doesn't have a right to do anything, has no say in the household. Now he says, thou art no more a servant, but a son. And so suddenly you have all the privileges of adulthood in the family of God. And it goes on to say in verse 7, and if a son, then an heir of God through Christ. And that's because of adoption. We become an heir of Jesus Christ. Okay, so let's continue on from that after looking at those seven verses. So the young child is of no more importance than his servant. He's adopted into the family as an adult. And though he was born into the family, he is now adopted into that same family with all the privileges of adulthood. And I closed my Bible. I shouldn't have done it. Galatians chapter 3, just back one chapter here. Thank you, Kay. You're very kind. I guess what goes around comes around, don't it? Okay. In Galatians chapter 3, verse 26, he says, "For ye are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus." You're children of God. That's how we come into God's family. We come in as children, but we just read that the child becomes an adult in the family of God through adoption. So when we get saved, we become a child of God. Now, in the same vein here, 1 John 3:2 says, "Beloved, now are we the sons of God. And it doth not yet appear what we shall be, but we know when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is." So we come into God's family as not babies, just babies, but as the sons of God. John 1:12, "As many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God." Not just children of God, but sons of God, adult sons of God. That's because of adoption. Now, in verses 4 and 5, and it tells us in Galatians, that's in Galatians 4 there, that God redeems us and that God adopts us. Let's look at verse 5 again. "To redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons." So we become redeemed and adopted. And remember, adoption is the placing into the family of God as adults and thus heirs of God. So when we get saved, there is redemption, the new birth, and adoption all taking place instantly. Now in verse 6, where it says we are no more, verse 6, "And because ye are sons, God hath sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father." Now that's an unusual expression, Abba, Father. We have that three times in the New Testament, and in the page we just looked at on the other second column there, here are the three times we have this word Abba. Every time you have the word Abba, you have Father right behind it. Mark 14:36, this is Jesus praying. He said, "Abba, Father, all things are possible unto thee. Take away this cup," and so forth. And then in Romans 8, we have it again. And I put the number of verses up here with it so you can see it in its context. "For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God." Okay, here it's talking about being a child of God or a son of God. "For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father." And then it goes on to say, "The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit. We are the children of God. And if children, then heirs. Heirs of God, joint heirs with Christ." And so Abba, Father, and adoption are linked together here, just as they are in the book of Galatians. Here's Galatians chapter 4 that we just looked at. Talks in verse 5 about the adoption of sons. Talks in verse 6 about Abba, Father. Now you say, what in the world is Abba? Well, we have a word akin to that in the English language. And that word is Dada, from which we get daddy. And thank you. That word is akin to that. And of course, dada means, that's a child's way of saying father. He can't say it. And so that's how it comes out. So one of their earliest words, you know, you have a little child, a newborn baby, and then he starts growing and he gets to be about 2 years old, starts to talk, and the dad wants him to say dada before he says mama. That's natural, but he never does. He always says mama first. But that's a little child's way of trying to express himself. Now, in the Greek language, and this, you'll be familiar with this, in the Greek language, the word for father is pater. You know, mother and father are mater and pater. Well, when a little child would try to say pater, it would come out papa. And that's where our word papa comes from. Now, we're not talking about English. We're not talking about Greek language here. We're talking about the Hebrew language here. The Hebrews did not go through this legal process of adoption, but God takes this legal process of adoption and applies it to the family of God. And so the language here is Hebrew. Now, in the Hebrew language, the Hebrew word for father is Ab. But the little child trying to say Ab comes out Abba, A-B-B-A. That's the word, well, I took it down, but that's the word that we have up there. And so it's a expression of a baby trying to call his father, Abba. And it speaks of the childlike faith, the unreasoning trust that a child has in his parents. If the parents, the parents are just the final authority in that little baby's life, or little toddler's life. The mom and dad have all the answers to every problem that he has or she has, and it's just this unreasoning trust. So the child would cry out Abba. However, you never have Abba by itself. It's always Abba, Father. And to say Father is an intelligent, speaks of an intelligent, understandable relationship. So the two phrases together, Abba, Father, are an expression of adoption. Abba, meaning you're a child, a babe in Christ, you've just been born again into the family of God, but immediately, Father, which speaks of adulthood. So when we're born into God's family, we're born as a babe in Christ, but placed or adopted as a full-grown adult into the greatest family on earth, the family of God. And that's why every time you have the word Abba in the New Testament, it's always followed by Father because of the process of adoption. So this is what adoption is all about. It's being placed into God's family as a full-blown heir of God, a joint heir with Jesus Christ. Now, the timeline of adoption is something different here. We have it in its three tenses, past and present and future. First of all, let's look at the past. And this is Ephesians chapter 1, verses 4, 5, and 6. It says, according as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world. So here's our timeline here now. Actually, it's before time, because before the foundation of the world, there was no time. But before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love, having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ. When were we adopted into the family of God? Before the world began. In the determined counsel and mind of God through his foreknowledge, he knew who would be saved and who would not be saved, and he had the idea of adoption way back there before Genesis 1:1, back there before God created the worlds, the universe, before any of that happened. He knew that Jesus was going to come and die for our sins, because the Bible says that he was the Lamb of God slain from before the foundation of the world. And before the foundation of the world, he knew who would be saved, and he adopted us into his family. So adoption took place way back there, eons of time ago, back in eternity. So in that sense, adoption is a past thing. Then secondly, it's a present thing. Galatians 4:5 again. to redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. That's something that happens in our lifetime when we get saved. When you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, you receive him into your heart, you are adopted into the family of God. You come in as an adult. And then thirdly, the future tense that is found here in Romans 8:23. It says, "And not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption." You say, what is that adoption we're waiting for? Well, he explains it. Waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our bodies. See, when God redeemed us, he redeemed our soul and our spirit. Our bodies, he hasn't redeemed yet, but he's going to redeem them. He's going to redeem our bodies. We're going to get a brand new body. And it's going to be an indestructible, immortal body. In fact, the Bible says it's going to be a body similar to the resurrection body of the Lord Jesus. We're going to have a body that won't age and won't get sick. Amen is right. You know where I spent last night? I spent last night, the whole stinking night, in the emergency room at St. Joe's Hospital. It was just about time to go to bed. My wife and I were sitting there watching TV. I just doubled up with a pain. And it was a pain that wouldn't go away. And I've had belly aches before. But man, this was a pain. And it just kept up and kept up. I tried to go to bed. And there was no position I could get in. It just kept getting worse and worse and worse. And then I heaved all over the place. And so... Now that's not funny.
Then they put a camera down at 2.
So then she says, "You better go." She says, "We better go to emergency." And I didn't argue with her. Now when a man says okay to his wife to go to the doctor, that means you are sick, baby. So we went, and it was a great time in the emergency room. Didn't get back home till it was almost 7 o'clock this morning. Found out a lot of interesting things about myself. I found out my heart's great. Found out my liver is great. Found out my gallbladder is great. I found out my pancreas is great. What I didn't find out was what was wrong with me. So I don't know what it was. But anyways, saying all that, there's a point to this. Saying all that, we're going to get a resurrection body. Stuff like that isn't going to happen. And it, not only will we not be sick and have pain and suffering and all of that, we're not going to age anymore. Too late for you, Judd, but we're not going to keep on getting older. And somebody said to me one time, "What, when we get our resurrection body, what age do you think we'll be? I mean, comparable to earthly bodies. What age do you think it'll be?"
And, 33.
Yeah, I think so, around 33, because that's how old Jesus was when he died. And so 33 is a good age. 33 is a great age. Be able to walk through walls, right? Jesus just came right through the wall there. And so the resurrection body is going to be far different from the bodies we know. Well, how do we get that resurrection body? Well, it's through adoption. We inherit that. That's part of our inheritance in the family of God. We're going to inherit a brand new body that is not subject to the laws of physics and the laws of nature that our present body is subject to, and it's going to be a wonderful experience. Okay, let's go to the next page then.
We'll be able to really appreciate it.
Oh, I imagine so. I imagine so. All right, now what does adoption do for us? Now we've seen in the last 3 weeks, we've seen regeneration, justification, and adoption. Okay, 2 weeks ago we looked at regeneration, which is the new birth. Regeneration gives us new life. Last week we saw justification, and that gives us a new standing. Remember, when we're justified, we're made perfect before God. That doesn't mean that we are perfect, it means God has made us perfect in the sense that we have a perfect standing before Him. There's a difference between our standing and our state, or our position from our condition, but the standing is perfect. So when we're justified, we're given a new standing, but in adoption, we're given a new position completely. So regeneration gives us new life, justification gives us a new standing, and adoption gives us a new position. We have adulthood, maturity through adoption. Even if we're just saved today, you're a tiny babe in Christ, in the importance that you hold in the family of God is that of an adult heir. You've been adopted into the family of God. Now in regeneration, that's the new birth, remember, the believer becomes a child of God. In justification, the believer becomes a perfect child. And in adoption, that child becomes an adult or a son. The minor becomes an adult, the infant becomes a legal heir. So this is what adoption does for us. It places us into the family of God as an adult and a joint heir with the Lord Jesus Christ. The blessings of adoption, we've put down six of them here, and these are the blessings that we get through adoption. First of all, we get the right to use the family name. Family name is Christian. Acts 11:26 tells us that the disciples were called Christians first in Antioch. A new word was coined in Antioch there in the early church, the word Christian. Did you know the word Christian is only found three times in the Bible? That's one of them. They were called Christians first in Antioch. Okay, it's the family name. The Bible says in Ephesians 3:14-15, "For this cause I bow my knees unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named." The family name is named after the Lord Jesus Christ. That's Christian. Christian is Christ with an I-A-N on the end of it. The word Christian identifies us with the Lord Jesus Christ. It's the family name. Unfortunately, the word Christian is a maligned term today, and it's used erroneously. You know, there was never a time in my life when I didn't think I was a Christian. I was raised to believe I was a Christian. And it wasn't until after I got saved and became a Christian that I realized that I hadn't been a Christian. But you're not a Christian till you're born into God's family. You become a child of God. So the family name, named after the Lord Jesus. Secondly, we take on the family likeness. In Romans 8:29, we read, "For whom he did foreknow, he did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son." The image of his Son. In 1 Corinthians 15, verse 49, it says that as we have borne the image of the earthly, so shall we bear the image of the heavenly. That's Jesus. Jesus is the perfect image of God the Father, and we become the perfect image of God the Son. You see, when God created man, the Bible says he created us in his own image. But that image became marred and distorted through sin. And that sin marred that image. We no longer bear the image of God. Now there's only one way to be restored to the image of God, and that is through the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible says in the book of Hebrews that Jesus is the express image of his person, speaking of God the Father. He's the perfect likeness of God the Father. Well, how do we get to regain or retain the image of God? Well, we have to look like Jesus, because Jesus looks like the Father. Somebody was talking to me this past week about how much somebody's son looked like their father. And they used an expression I hadn't heard before. They said, yeah, the nuts don't fall very far from the tree. When they fall, they stay close by. Well, that's true. The children do look like their parents many times. We bear the image of our Heavenly Father because we bear the image of Jesus. And so the scripture says here, we're conformed to the image of his son. Then thirdly, the family love. Before we read that, I think I told you this before, I'm an only child. And yeah, I did. We talked about that in this class once. I asked how many of you were only children. We had a few. And it's rough growing up, being an only child. And but I observed something when I was growing up. You know, kids fight. And there's always fights going on with kids, you know. And I observed something that if I was around any brothers, they might fight with each other like cats and dogs. You know, I got two sons. They're in their mid-30s now, but from the time they were old enough to toddle, they fought. And you know what? It don't get any better. They still keep doing it. And they argue with each other, you know, but they love each other. That's an amazing thing. Brothers love each other. And I noticed that you could, brothers would get in a fight, they'd wail the tar out of one another, but if someone else came along and got in a fight with one of those brothers, he had two of them to contend with. It's just that family love is there, that family bond. Well, that's the way it is in the family of God. In John 13, 34 and 35, Jesus said, "A new commandment I give you, that ye love one another as I have loved you, that ye also love one another. And by this shall all men know that you're my disciples, if you have love one for another." That doesn't mean that we won't ever dispute with another believer, but the love has to be there, and we're known by our love. So it's a family kind of love. That's the strongest love that there is, a family kind of love. And then fourthly, the family spirit. Romans 8:16 says, "If ye live after the flesh, ye shall die, but if through the spirit you do mortify the deeds of the body, you shall live." And so there's a whole new life there through the Holy Spirit. So the family spirit here is the third person of the Godhead, the Holy Spirit of God. And if we live in the Spirit and through the Spirit, we mortify the deeds of the flesh. That word mortify is the word that our English word mortician comes from. Oh, Grace isn't here tonight. She works for a mortician. And but that's what it comes from. It means an undertaker. He says, and it has to do with death. He says, if you live through the Spirit, or through the Holy Spirit, you put to death the deeds of the body, or the deeds of the flesh. And then fifthly, there's another benefit of adoption, the family responsibilities. Any blessings, always the other side of the coin is there's always the responsibility that comes with it. And in John 14, 23 and 24, Jesus answered and said unto him, "If a man love me, he will keep my words." If a man love me, he will keep my words. And then he says, "My Father will love him. We will come unto him, make our abode in him." And then he says it again, "He that loveth me not, keepeth not my sayings." So on the basis of that, we know that we belong to Christ if we are living in obedient to his word. You know, there was a story used to be told, and this guy had a girlfriend, and he used to write letters to her every night. Every night he'd write her a love letter. He'd say, "For you, I would climb the highest mountain. I'd swim the broadest ocean. I'd brave the fires and storms. I'd do anything for you." And he goes on and on and on in this letter. And then he closes and says, "I'll be over to see you Saturday night if it's not raining." Well, something about what he said just lost it when he said that. Well, if a man love me, he will keep my words. It's not... if it's raining, or if this comes along, or this happens, that isn't have anything to do with it. If we love him, we're going to keep his word. Now, that's not to say we never slip, backslide, and so forth. The Lord's going to call you back if you do. If you're a true child of God, God's going to call you back again. So we have a family responsibility. In that verse, it says, We'll love him, and we'll come unto him, and make our abode with him. Those three things. Love him, come unto him, and make our abode with him. This is what God does for his children. We've been adopted into the family of God. All right, and then sixthly, the family inheritance. And this is primarily what adoption was all about originally, the original use of adoption there, the family inheritance. In 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 to 5, it talks about our inheritance. Now, a child could not inherit. A baby could not inherit. Only an adult person, someone who has come to years, somebody who's officially adult, can receive an inheritance, and that is true in this life as well as in the family of God. Now, 1 Peter, he says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again." See that phrase, begotten us again? That's born again. Begotten means born. We've been born again unto a lively or a living hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. We've been born again for that, to an inheritance. What kind of an inheritance? Incorruptible, undefiled, one that fadeth not away, and reserved in heaven for you. Reserved in heaven for you. That's the inheritance that is waiting for us. And it says it's waiting for you. It's reserved in heaven. You've got a reserved place in heaven, a reservation in heaven. It's good to have a reservation. Now, this inheritance is incorruptible and undefiled. Part of that inheritance we already talked about is our new bodies, resurrection bodies. And they're going to be immortal and incorruptible. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, where it talks about the resurrection, he says, "This mortal shall put on immortality, and this corruptible shall put on incorruption." So this new body that we get, that we're going to inherit, it's going to be immortal and incorruptible. 1 Corinthians 15:50 says, "Flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, neither doth corruption inherit corruption." So we have to have a perfect body. So we have a perfect standing before God through justification. We have a perfect inheritance, a perfect body before God through adoption. All right, then going on, Romans 8:17 says, "And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, joint heirs with Christ." Now the Bible tells us in the book of Hebrews that Jesus is the heir of all things. He's the Father's heir. He's the heir of all things. But here in Romans we read we're joint heirs with him. Well, that's pretty good. If God owns the cattle on 1,000 hills and the wealth in every mind, as the old chorus goes, he owns all things, his heir is Jesus Christ, we're joint heirs with him also. That's why it goes on to say, "If so be that we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified together." And then the verse we already saw in another light is Romans chapter 8. "Not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption to wit, the redemption of our body." That's the new body there as the inheritance. Now, in the first chapter of Ephesians, we also read some other things concerning the adoption. And we want to introduce to you another term here. Ephesians chapter 1, we're going to read from verses 11 through verse 14. Now it's talking about this inheritance. Okay? It says, "In whom also we have obtained an inheritance." How do we do that? We were adopted into the family of God. That inheritance, we've obtained it. It's spoken of in past tense, or even though we haven't got it yet. It's a sure thing. We've obtained it. We have a legal right to it. We've obtained an inheritance, being predestinated according to the purpose of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his own will, that we should be to the praise of his glory who first trusted in Christ. In whom ye also trusted after. After what? After ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. In whom also after. After ye believed, you were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. See the progression here? You trust in Christ, but you can't trust in Christ until you've heard the word of truth, the gospel of our salvation. After you hear it, faith cometh by hearing, hearing by the word of God. After you hear it, you believed. And after you believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. That's the regeneration there, the new birth. And it's, notice it says that Holy Spirit of promise, we're sealed with that Holy Spirit, which is the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession unto the praise of his glory. Now that word earnest there is a word that is pretty much passed out of usage in the English language. It was used up until the 20th century. I guess we're still in the 20th century, aren't we? Till next year. Well, yeah, the new century don't start.
Now, they say.
That what?
We have started. Once you enter that one, you start the next one.
Oh, okay, whatever. Well, anyways, throughout the latter days of the 19th century and on into the early days of the 20th century, this word was still in vogue. It was still being used. And what it means is a down payment. You maybe have heard the expression earnest money. That it's still used in legal circles. Earnest money. It means a down payment. Now, this has to do with our adoption. The Holy Spirit is the down payment on our inheritance. That's what it's saying here. He is the down payment. He is the one who guarantees that the payment has been made. Now, the payment was made by the Lord Jesus Christ, and it was made completely. There's nothing left to pay. Jesus paid it all, as the hymn writer put it. All to him we owe. He paid everything. However, for our inheritance, the guarantee of this, that the debt of our sin has been paid, is the Holy Spirit who has sealed us. He has sealed us. And he himself has become the down payment of our inheritance. Now, we read about this word earnest a couple other places in the New Testament, and it's always connected with the Holy Spirit, and it always means the same thing. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 22 says, who hath also sealed us? That's what we read about the Holy Spirit here. We were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. He sealed us and given the earnest of the Spirit in our hearts, the down payment for our redemption. That's how sure adoption is, that we receive this inheritance. It's guaranteed. That's what earnest money does. It guarantees the purchase and the payment of whatever it is you're buying there. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 uses it again. Now he that hath wrought us for the self same thing is God, who also hath given unto us the earnest of the Spirit. So every time we have this word earnest, it's always talking about the Holy Spirit as being the down payment for our redemption, our salvation, our regeneration, our justification, our adoption, and sanctification, which is our next lesson, sanctification. So God guarantees to us all of the blessings he promised to us. It's for sure. Jesus said, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. And I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. Guaranteed. It's guaranteed. We had a house for sale few years ago. Somebody came, put down some money to buy the house, and then they didn't buy it. they got out of the deal. And even though there was a down payment, they got out of the deal. It was contingent on sale of their house and so forth. It didn't work out. That doesn't work in the family of God. It's not contingent upon anything. It's the blessings of God, the inheritance of God is sealed. And the seal that is used to seal it, just like in a legal document, it's sealed. The seal that is used is the Holy Spirit himself, the third person of the Godhead, guaranteeing us all the promises and blessing that we read in the Word of God. They're ours for all eternity. See how important you are in Christ? We're somebody in Christ. You may not be a big shot in this world, but even the weakest saint of God is somebody in the family of God. In God's family, you and I are very important, and so important that he shed his blood to redeem us unto himself. Well, next week, there won't be a class. There won't be anything next week. No house-to-house TLC groups, no Awana, nothing next week. It's Easter week. And then when we start up after Easter, we have three more sessions left. The first one, we're going to look at sanctification. Don't let that word scare you. There's a lot of things that are connected with sanctification that you don't find in the Bible. You turn on some of these TV programs and you can be scared out of your wits through what is called sanctification. You don't read that in the Word of God. Sanctification is something very special in the Word of God, and it happens to us when we get saved. Then the following week, we're going to look at eternal security. How secure are we in our salvation? And then the final week is assurance of salvation. If you ever doubt your salvation, and I think if we're honest, we say that at some time or other, we've all doubted whether we've really been saved. Satan comes at us, and during a moment of trial or a moment of weakness, you think you're really saved? Well, we'll show you from the Word of God how to cope with that and show Satan that you are saved. You know that you're saved. Okay, let's look to God in prayer, and we'll be dismissed now. Heavenly Father, we're thankful for each one that has come tonight, and we pray that this lesson of adoption will be a special blessing to each one of us. Lord, we just thank you that you've made us somebody in the family of God, that we're important enough to not only have you die for our sins and to cause us to be born into your family, but you've adopted us as well and made us joint heirs with Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord, for all you've done for us. Lord, we could do nothing when we deserve nothing, but you've done it all for us. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Help us never to lose sight of that. Now dismiss us, we will pray, in Jesus' precious name, with your blessing upon us. Amen. Thank you very much for coming.